This episode was brought to you by Pentester Academy, the leader in online cybersecurity education. Join over 10,000 professionals from 90 countries to learn security online. Also brought to you by Hacker Arsenal, artillery for cyber warriors. Visit us on hackerarsenal.com to check out our latest attack defense gadgets. I'm Marley Oxenholm from Pentester Academy TV, and welcome to our show, Access Point, where we spotlight cybersecurity companies and give an inside look at the people and technology behind the latest advancements in the industry.
I'm joined today by Engin Kerida, who is co-founder and chief architect of the company Lastline. Thank you for joining me today.
Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure to be here.
Absolutely. I'm excited to have you on and learn more about the company. So let's get started. So first off, can you talk about the founding story of the company? How did you guys get started?
Sure. So I actually am wearing two hats. I'm one of the co-founders of Lastline, but I'm also a professor of computer science at Northeastern University. The two other co-founders, Giovanni Vigna and Chris Krugel, are professors at the University of California, Santa Barbara. So we have been active in the area of cybersecurity for the last 15 years, a little longer than that. But we've been specifically working on malware, you know, better ways of detecting malware, analysis systems for the last decade or so. And we built a bunch of tools that were a part of our research that ended up being very, very popular. People were asking us, hey, can we actually buy these tools? We couldn't sell them because it was, you know, a product of our research. But we decided, hey, maybe we'll build better tools. Let's create a company and let's do more research in this domain and create professional tools that people can actually enjoy and use in their businesses. So that's basically the founding story of Lastline. And since then, we've been quite active in industry with the company as well.
Very nice. Okay. And now, what exactly does the company do? What would be your elevator pitch?
Sure. So we're in the business of detecting sophisticated attacks. A lot of the attacks these days are actually backed by malware. So we have techniques, we have heuristics, detection methods for detecting sophisticated malware. So our analysis looks into things that actually come into organizations. We try to extract the behaviors of these things, these potentially malicious things. And we look into many, many different sensors, different things we see in a network, and try to identify sophisticated modern attacks. So basically, we're in the breach detection business, and we try to detect attacks as quickly as possible after they have happened, but we also try to block attacks in sophisticated cases. Especially, we're very interested in detecting targeted, so-called APT type of attacks. So where, you know, sophisticated people are behind these attacks and they use more modern techniques to make the attacks difficult to detect.
Okay, got it. And now I'm wondering, you know, given your years of experience, how do you think that the threat landscape has changed over the past few years?
You know, as a researcher, if you look at the entire cybersecurity landscape, right, or if you look at the attack landscape, conceptually, actually not too many things have changed, right? So there is malware, and, you know, there was malware 15 years ago as well. So there's a change in the level of sophistication of the code we're seeing, so the malware itself. Yes, maybe it's a bit more sophisticated, but in many of the cases, they still use the same techniques, right? So malware evolves faster these days. We're seeing the actors change. So you're seeing the move to, you know, larger groups maybe, or smaller groups that are more motivated in launching these attacks. You know, you're seeing things like ransomware that we didn't see before, although the idea is actually not very new, right? Ransomware idea has been around since like since the 80s, right? End of the 80s. So conceptually, not much has changed, but malware has become a bigger business. And I think one sort of interesting thing from a research point of view is that we're actually seeing more and more targeted attacks. So nation states sometimes, sometimes individual groups who specifically target organizations, who specifically write malware that targets a very specific organization. So that is something we didn't see 10 years ago, although we knew it was possible. We were not seeing it a lot. But these days, it's mainstream, right? A lot of organizations, independent of the size, might actually be targeted by these very specific types of malware that are unknown, that have been specifically written for certain organizations. So detecting them, of course, is a larger challenge. And, you know, we do our best to try to detect these types of attacks.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with you, especially about how rapidly a lot of these attacks have escalated lately. It is out of hand. It's crazy. And speaking of attacks, I'm wondering, with so many organizations under attack lately, what do you see as their biggest concern, and what are some ways that they should be defending themselves?
I think many people realize today, many organizations realize that malware is indeed a problem. So, you know, when you talk to people 10 years ago, yes, they were being infected by malware, but they were less concerned about that, because they didn't feel the pain directly. Today, people are feeling the pain. If you're a small organization, a small company that gets hit by malware, and suppose they manage to steal $10 million or I don't know, $1 million, you don't get that money back. That money, you're liable for it. You end up paying for it. So we actually seen companies that go out of business because they lost a lot of money to malware. Yep. So that's, you know, people have started feeling the pain. And especially things like ransomware have become sort of educational in the sense that more and more companies are getting infected by ransomware.
True.
They feel the pain because they lose the data. And I think, you know, I would say many organizations, also smaller organizations, are now worried about malware just because they're seeing the direct effects of it, which was not the case, say, 10 years ago.
Yeah, no, absolutely. It's not. It hasn't been this bad in a while. So I'm wondering now, what differentiates your malware protection solutions from other ones available on the market?
Yeah, that's a good question. There are many, many solutions out there, of course, right? I think one main differentiator for us is the way we detect the malware. So in terms of the detection quality, a lot of people tell us that we're actually doing a good job because we use more dynamic techniques, we use more heuristics, some machine learning as well, to try to do a better detection and more in-depth understanding of what we're actually seeing. Mm-hmm. So that is a key differentiator, the quality of the detection. But also we built a solution that we've integrated with a bunch of other solutions out there. Today, if you are creating a security solution, we believe it's very, very important to be able to come up with something that is flexible in the sense that if you have existing solutions, you can just plug it in. Or if you want to build something on top of the solution, hopefully it'll be possible to build things on top of it. So we have almost APIs for everything we have in the solution. And, you know, you can buy for certain components of it, or you can buy the entire thing, but it's a very, very flexible architecture that allows you to focus on what you need rather than us building something and saying, hey, just take all of that and you need all of that. So, you know, the ability to integrate is, I think, very important. And we have a lot of OEM relationships where, you know, you might know a company that actually uses us as the backend because we do this detection really well. So, you know, that's, I think, one of our key strengths.
Very nice. Okay. And now I'm wondering that, you know, as attackers become more sophisticated and develop all of these new techniques, how does your team, you know, not just keep up with all of these advancing threats, but stay ahead of them as well?
Right. That's a great question. So as you say, unfortunately, it's the security domain. It's a cat and mouse game, right? So it's an arms race.
Yeah.
If you come up with a solution, obviously the attackers are going to look into ways of evasion, right? So evasion is actually something that we invest a lot of effort in. All the solutions we have, we constantly think about how can we make this more evasion resistant. So all the, you know, sandboxing we do, all the analysis we do, we always think about that. But I think what we're really investing in is automation. So a lot of solutions out there, you know, might try to, or companies might try to solve a problem by throwing people at the problem. You know, if you have 1,000 engineers, maybe you think you're going to do a better job. But we think automation is the key. So everything we do, the threats intelligence, the analysis, we try to automate that by using heuristics, by using techniques, some machine learning, to try to do things automatically that people typically do by hand. So there's this constant push for innovation, coming up with better techniques, you know, extracting the threat intelligence automatically. And I sincerely believe that that's the only way to deal with the threat. Maybe you can't solve the problem, but hopefully, using automation, you'll always be able to keep it in check. So if you have something that gets bypassed, you come up with a solution quickly or use some automation to come up with a better technique. So if you're able to do that, then you're always ahead of the game, right? And hopefully that's going to then help you keep the problem in check.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Especially if you can increase the efficiency overall and allow them to focus on what really matters at that point, that's huge.
Right.
And so now, what kinds of companies are adopting your solution?
So cybersecurity is a general problem. So our customers come from all sorts of different backgrounds. know, the financial sector, the health sector, educational mm-hmm. sectors, almost anything you can think of, any organization that has some sort of an IT infrastructure would be interested in using a solution like Lastline because of the malware problem. Because some of the attacks are targeted, but a lot of the attacks are also opportunistic in the sense that the attackers attack everybody, right? So if you say, hey, I'm not important enough, I'm not going to be attacked, at some point you might discover that, hey, you've been infected by ransomware. So our customers have a wide range of different backgrounds. But mainly we target medium to large enterprises right now because smaller enterprises might not have the right resources. But over time, I think that's going to change. A lot of solutions like Lifeline are going to be mainstream.
Right. Okay. And can you give a case study example of how you're able to help one of the customers out?
Sure. So we had a customer in the financial sector that actually got hit by ransomware. And because of the way we are situated, you actually see a lot of what's happening in the network. In their specific case, we were actually able to capture the traffic of the ransomware with the command and control services, which actually meant that we were able to see the encryption key being sent out. So at some point, they were very fortunate to take that key and get access to all their data again, right? So it's very important to see what's happening in the network. Some people call that situational awareness. So you want to be able to see what's happening in the network, capture some of that data, and hopefully, in some of the cases, you might be able to block the attack. In some of the cases, you might even be able to retrieve the data that has been actually attacked by the attackers.
Yeah, absolutely. That's huge. And now, lastly, what developments can we expect to see down the line from your team, and what does the company roadmap look like?
So I think a lot of people in the industry now realize and they agree that all these solutions, many of these solutions are, they're very, very reactive. So there's this tendency, if you look at traditional AV technology, that you say, I've detected an attack, you try to fix it, you inform people, but that is not very effective. So we are putting a lot of effort into being more proactive. So rather than just detecting attacks and saying to people, hey, here's an attack, we have new products, new technologies that might detect an attack, but then proactively looks for similar attacks that are happening in your organization, or we see that somebody else is seeing the attack, so we can use some sort of AI, some machine learning to see, and some classification to see, hey, would that be relevant for you? So we have a product called Breach Defender that is actually generating quite a bit of interest from our customers.
Nice.
That aims to do that. So rather than just being reactive, that allows you to hunt for threats rather than just wait to be attacked. So I think that's going to be very important going forward.
Wonderful. That sounds very exciting. Thank you so much for sitting down with me today and talking to me about Lastline. This was really interesting. I appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Take care and we'll talk to you soon.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Also, make sure to subscribe to our YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook so you don't miss out on any of the latest cybersecurity news. This episode is brought to you by Pentester Academy, the leader in online cybersecurity education. Join over 10,000 professionals from 90 countries to learn security online. Also brought to you by Hacker Arsenal, artillery for cyber warriors. Visit us on hackerarsenal.com to check out our latest attack defense gadgets. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.